Going to call the meeting to order and rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome, everyone. Seems like we have a fairly crowded house tonight. Thanks for coming. Murray, would you please take the roll?
Director Wallace.
Present.
Director Nicholson.
Present.
Director Stewart.
Present.
Director Danielson.
Present.
Director Ethan.
Present.
Thank you. Would you like to introduce the education session?
Yes, I'm very happy to. We have two education sessions tonight. The first is Nursing Transforming Care at the Bedside, which has very direct relevance to our efforts at becoming and maintaining the magnet status. And we'll start with Stephanie Williams. She's been at Washington Hospital for 13 years. She's a registered nurse with a master's degree in healthcare administration and is also a certified professional in healthcare quality. Stephanie has oversight for quality, case management, social services, spiritual care, diabetes, and the stroke departments. She was also recently promoted to the chief nursing officer's position here at Washington Hospital. I'll turn the program over to Stephanie.
Thank you, Nancy. This is National Nurses Week. It runs from May 6th through the 12th, and the 12th is the birthday of Florence Nightingale. We celebrate our nurses and recognize their skills, their compassion, and their commitment towards improving care of our district residents. I first want to acknowledge our CEO, Nancy Farber, our CNO for the past 20 years, Jan Wood, and the Board of Directors, for without their vision, leadership, and support, nursing at Washington Hospital would not be where it is today. I now invite you to come along with us on our journey to nursing excellence as care is transformed at the bedside. Our journey will end by hearing from a few of our nurses about their quest to improving care at the bedside. The theme for 2012 is advocating, leading, and caring. And our nurses at Washington Hospital support the interests of our patients by embracing our patient-first ethics to provide patient-centered care, by participating in interdisciplinary care conferences, putting the patient first, and by always looking for opportunities to improve the care that's delivered at the bedside. Now, here's a picture of one of our new grad programs with our CNO. We are the only new grad RN program in the Bay Area that's truly formalized. So that in itself is an accomplishment for our nurses. Leadership. Our nurses provide direct support for patient-centered care. They embrace their professional practice model for nursing. They become certified in their specialty and obtain advanced degree. They integrate best practices at the bedside. And they participate in the shared governance structure at the unit and at the organization level. Here is a picture of our staff nurse threes and fours. And these are nurses that have gone beyond the basics in terms of clinical accomplishment. These can be your charge nurses. You'll see the stroke nurses in here. So these are some of our specialty nurses. Caring, this is what we do at Washington Hospital. The nurse demonstrates concern and empathy for others by acting as patient navigators, implementing patient safety practices, and participating in population-specific programs such as our sexual assault program, stroke, sepsis, and palliative care. Research has shown that nurses that take an active role in problem solving and decision making improves care at the bedside and leads to an innovative environment. So here are some of our nursing councils where there is problem solving and decision making. It involves all aspects of nursing and it also involves the ancillary departments as well. We have an administrative council. We have a clinical council that has oversight for the clinical practice. We have an education council, And we have a quality council that looks to see how we are doing and what else we need to work on. This has been our biggest accomplishment. September 16, 2011, we accomplished the highest quality of nursing practice and exemplary care. We became magnets. And here is a picture of our first designation at the Magnet Conference with our CNO and our nurses. We could not have done this alone. And we also pay tribute to the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation. And most of you know that Betty and Gordon and Betty Moore are the founders of InHealth. And Betty Moore suffered complications as a result of medical errors. And with that, her goal became a priority to improve nursing care. So she started an initiative in 2003 to improve the quality of patient and nursing-related outcomes. This encompassed the Bay Area, the Bay Area and the Sacramento area. Let's talk about the goals of the Moore Foundation, because it truly ties with our patient-first ethics. Implement more effective RN best practices, create a system to support patient safety, and improve discharge planning for our high-risk seniors. We got many support from the Moore Foundation. We got many grants from them. And this was one of the first grants we received in 2005. And this was in the midst of the nursing shortage. And it was to support the nursing workforce. So Washington Hospital, in collaboration with the nursing schools and other hospitals, created a workforce by increasing the nurses in this area by 60 by 2010. And they met that goal. So let's talk about how the Moore Foundation has helped us with our journey to nursing excellence. The implementation of the SimLab, October 2007 to 2010. This is where nurses get and students get hands-on experience and learn this craft in a realistic environment. This is an example of our nurses in our SimLab. We knew we wanted to be magnets, and their support and the Moore Foundation helped us with that. They enabled us to hire magnet consultants to come and do a gap analysis for us to let us know where we are, where the gaps are, what are the things we needed to work on. And that occurred in 2007. Evidence-based practice initiative. This was the beginning of transforming care at the bedside. Two of the grants we got initially that ran from 2007 to present, one had to do with preventing hospital-acquired pneumonia for patients that were non-vented. And this was the MedSurg project. The lessons learned from this, the measures that we have implemented, is how we practice today. The sepsis, you know, we were the early adopters of the sepsis campaign. We were the only community hospital ever invited to the International Sepsis Conference. We have gone twice, and we have gotten our posters published. Nursing research. As part of the Magnet Readiness Grant, we had to do research. We had to look at evidence-based practice in nursing. And one of the research we did was using the rapid response team to reduce sepsis. This allowed the nurses and the rapid response team to identify early identification of sepsis. Here we have our research council, which was initiated at that point in time. And these are some of the members of that council. And the lessons learned from this research is still in practice today. Again, we're talking about transforming care at the bedside, and that's how we do it, one step at a time. The professional role of the nurse with Maria O'Rourke. Studies have shown, and Dr. O'Rourke is a leader in this field, in terms of when nurses know their role and their scope of practice, it improves their clinical practice. We put over 700 nurses trained under Marie O'Rourke model. This became part of our care model for our magnet. It's now incorporated into our new employee orientation. And yes, we did see a difference, because knowing their role, it definitely showed an improvement in care at the bedside. Evidence-based practice phase one. This is what nursing is all about. This is the future of nursing. Making the decisions at the bedside that impacts patient care. Take into consideration the patient wants, their preferences, and based on their knowledge and based on the research, doing what's best for them. And the Moore Foundation certainly helped us with this. We were able to do 10 evidence-based projects and completed all of them. We got many of those projects were presented at posters presentation, at conferences, and one was even presented at IHI. We could not have done this without the Moore Foundation. They allowed us to bring in national experts here on site at Washington Hospital to train the nurses and be part of that team. Let's talk a little bit about evidence-based practice, because I think you have heard it enough throughout this presentation. It's a problem-solving approach using evidence of best practice in combination with nursing expertise and patient preference to lead to best patient outcome. It is outcome-driven. It's all about the patient. It's all about the delivery of care at the bedside. We can do small tests of change based on specific population. And we will talk a little bit about embarking upon phase two of our evidence-based practice. Phase two started in 2011, and tonight you're going to be hearing from the nurses about their quest to improving care at the bedside. We have 4 projects in place right now: nursing-based pain assessment and pain control education, teamwork and communication, end-of-life education, alcohol use screening and alcohol withdrawal symptoms monitoring in adult admitted patients. Every one of these projects is designed to improve care at the bedside. So let me introduce Kevin Brunson Castain, RN, PhD. He's currently enrolled in the Master Entry Program in Nursing. He has a Bachelor of Science in Psychology, a Doctorate of Philosophy in Clinical Diabetes Research. He entered our new grad program in the fall of 2010. He is a valuable member of the medical surgical flow team and has lent his expertise and support to numerous areas, including diabetes education and the quality department. I welcome Kevin.
Thank you. Thank you, Stephanie. So I actually first want to appreciate the administration for the opportunity to work on some of these projects. They are very important to us, and it's unique to have the opportunity to actually work on some of these projects and actually see and put some of these practices to work at the bedside. So the topic that I'm going to be talking about is looking at pain management in the hospital. Pain is a big issue. It's a big issue in nursing. It's something we deal with on a daily basis. And it's an important component of our patient's experience while they're here with us in the hospital. So what we've done is we've put together a multidisciplinary team of nurses and pharmacists. And we looked at the current evidence-based literature. And what we found is that nursing education that is focused on pain management, as well as current best practices, can have a positive impact on our patient population. So this initial phase of the project is focused on 6 West population. And then based on this initial data, we hope to roll it out later on hospital-wide. So the purpose of the project is to take this current evidence-based literature and actually put it into practice and incorporate it into our clinical decision-making. We're doing this through a nursing-based pain education program that focuses on current evidence-based practice. The ultimate goal is to improve our nursing knowledge base, as well as improve pain management in the hospital, and ultimately improve our patient satisfaction with the pain management while they're here with us. So that's my topic. I'd like to introduce Lita Hughes. She's a graduate of Cal State East Bay University with a degree in Bachelor of Science in Nursing. She's been with us for 29 years. She is a charge nurse and a staff nurse 3 on the short stay unit, and she also works in the Sandy Amos RN Infusion Center.
Thank you, Kevin. Our project is to assess the effectiveness of teamwork and communication that will enhance multidisciplinary communication and collaboration with the clinicians at Washington Hospital. The importance of this of our project is to base an education program on evidence that was found in the literature, and using this concept to put together a program that would enhance communication and collaboration in the team step. Team steps was a tool and strategy developed by the U.S. Department of Defense and Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality. Expected outcomes for patients is to improve the knowledge, education, and teamwork among our multidisciplinary team. Why is this important to me? It's because that's exactly what I would like, is knowledge, communication skills, and teamwork that is directly involved at the bedside. Thank you. I would like to introduce Kelly Anderson. She has a master's degree as a clinical nurse leader from the University of San Francisco. She also has a bachelor's science in psychology from the University of California at Davis, and has been a nurse at Washington Hospital for 3 years, and currently works on 3 West.
Hi, so I'm Kelly, and I represent End of Life. Our project is to assess the knowledge and attitudes of clinicians post-evidence-based end-of-life care education, and we are piloting this project on 4 West and ICU. The importance of this project is that the literature shows that the attitudes and comfort levels of clinicians related to palliative care impacts end-of-life care. Our expected outcomes are improved knowledge, attitudes, and comfort levels related to end-of-life care among our healthcare provider team at Washington Hospital. Our goal is to eventually improve patient and family satisfaction. This project is important to me personally because as a staff nurse, I work with patients who are at the end of life and their families, and I see how our care impacts their experience. Next, I'm going to introduce Noor Zareen, RN with a Master's of Science with an emphasis in nursing administration from San Jose State University. His entire nursing career has been at Washington Hospital for 9 years, and he has worked on 3 West, 4 West, and currently in the intensive care unit.
Thank you, Kelly. Our pilot project is focused on early detection of alcohol withdrawal using an evidence-based alcohol screening and withdrawal tool. The reason why our project is important is because at-risk patients will be assessed and screened using the World Health Organization Alcohol Use Disorder Identification Test, which is also known as AUDIT for short. And we are also using the Clinical Institute Withdrawal Assessment Tool, which is also known as CIWA for short. Both tools will be utilized in our study if indicated, and the study will be piloted on 3 West, which is a medical floor. The expected outcome for our study is our patients will have an improved management, the expected outcomes for our patients is that we will have improved the management of patients at risk for acute alcohol-related diagnosis. The project is important to me professionally because as a clinician, it's fundamental to delivering the highest quality of healthcare and ensuring the best possible outcome for our patients at Washington Hospital. We would like to thank Nancy Farber and all the board members for inviting us, and we would like to answer any questions that you may have at this time. Thank you.
Questions, anyone?
No questions, but I got a comment. I think you guys are doing just such a great job. I mean, it's just, it's amazing, really, really important work. I've seen the benefits with one of my own family members who's still with us today because of what you have done in actually implementing the best practices. It's one thing to talk about best practices and say, here's what they are. The hard work, which you've done, is actually make it happen at the bedside. And I can tell you, I was just so impressed when I saw that in action. It was a beautiful thing to see all the right things happen without me saying a word. Everything happened. And so I'm just deeply impressed and have heartfelt gratitude for the kind of work that you've done, because you truly are, in the title of your presentation, transforming. A very powerful word, transforming. Care. That's what we do. That's who we are. And we're doing it, we're doing that transformation right where it matters, right at the bedside, for the patient. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm very, very proud of our nursing programs. I'm very proud of each and every one of you. Mother's Day is coming up very shortly, and I know that every mother, all of your mothers, have got to be extremely proud of you. And I don't have the direct experience that Bill has with all of you on the floor, but I do hear what you're doing in the community from the patients that you have taken care of, and they are just so thankful. You've been credited for saving their lives. It really, really makes me feel very, very special and very good. And like Bill, all I can say is thank you very, very much for doing what you're doing, and keep it up.
All right, well, thank you very much for your presentation. Thank you for being here, and thank you for all of your good work. Thank you. Okay, we are now going to move on to the operating room.
And it occurs to me that timing-wise, it might be the moment in time to take something that I was going to mention in the House Hospital Calendar Report and announce it here with our nurses in the audience. The 2012 health grades ratings are in, and we are the recipient of the Health Grade Stroke Care Excellence Award. We are ranked among the top 5% in the nation for treatment of stroke. And we are also a 5-star recipient for neurosciences in 2012, specifically for back, neck, surgery, spinal fusion. And of course, per usual, we're rated in the top programs in California, in the top 5% in the country for orthopedics. To have three of our major programs be recognized in the top 5% of the country is a really big deal. And it takes a partnership of all the clinicians, the members of the medical staff, the members of the nursing staff, the respiratory care folks, everybody, physical therapy, occupational therapy, the lab, radiology, everybody becomes a part of this. And we'll be announcing this in further public venues in the coming weeks. This is a really big deal. I don't know how many hospitals have the distinction of having three of their major service initiatives to be recognized in the top 5% in the country. I want to thank the nurses here for helping us get there. Thank you. Now we will talk about operating room one. This is a place that most members of the public will never see.
You're right.
And we spent quite a bit of money in creating operating room number one, And operating room number two, which will be its mirror image, is already on its way and in construction. Operating room came online within the last few weeks. I know that the board had the opportunity to go over and look at it, but the general public will never see it. And so I asked our community relations staff and Ed Fain to put together a film that would show what it looks like in there. Ed? He's been lurking.
Thanks, Nancy. So, as Nancy stated, we undertook this project actually starting several years ago to renovate or to build actually two new ORs and then renovate two ORs that happened to be in the oldest section of the hospital and were originally put online in 1958. And in doing so, we took the opportunity to put specialty equipment in one of the original ORs to meet the needs of our growing neurosciences program. This room can be used for other things besides neurosciences, a whole variety of cases like laparoscopic, but I want to focus on the neurosciences because that's where the specialty equipment comes into play. So there's three main pieces of equipment that are in here that you'll see in the ensuing video. One of them is called the Brain Lab Brain Suite. One of them is called the Neurologica Body Tome. And the third one is called Global Care Quest. The Brain Lab Suite is actually a navigation system. The Neurologica Body Tome is a portable CT scanner that can be used intraoperatively or during a case. And the third is GCQ, or Global Care Quest, which is a database that stores images from all different modalities from the radiology departments and other clinical information as needed. And so the three of them basically work together, with the navigation system being used to pinpoint exact locations in the spine and head for incisions, insertion of equipment, and finally insertion of hardware for a variety of orthopedic and neurosurgical cases. That is guided, the system is guided by the images that come from the CT scan that get loaded into the navigation system. And then the GCQ allows other images to be seen in the room of things that were taken of the patient prior to surgery and are reference points for the surgeons. So, as Nancy said, we have a short video that was put together by our community relations department, and it will take you on a journey of sorts with Dr. Tagioff leading the way of how we got here, and then hearing from various surgeons how they what their view is for this OR for the future.
The date, Friday the 13th of July, the year 1973. I had just completed my residency at the Cleveland Clinic, one of the very finest in our land, and came out west to seek my fortune. I had just arrived and came into the OR here at Washington Hospital to do my very first case, with just a handful of basic instruments. Fortunately, my patient survived. And I learned then that I loved this hospital and that this is going to be my home. That year, the first CT scanner came into production, and soon we were spiraled into the era of the MRI scan. 32 years later, at the end of 2005, I decided to retire from a very busy neurosurgical practice and call it quits. Nancy Farber, our visionary CEO, approached me and said, "You cannot retire. We have work to do." She asked me then to create a neuroscience center like none other. I gave it some thought and consented. I had just removed a highly malignant brain tumor from a very dear and much loved colleague and friend, our in-house counsel, Taylor McAdam Bell. He struggled with his illness for 3 long years. And when he finally died, our administrator, Nancy Farber, and our board of directors decided to assign a neuroscience center his name and the Taylor McAdam Bell Neuroscience Center was born. I realized then that in order to have a world-class center, we needed world-class physicians. Fortunately, I had a world-class hospital administrator and a board of directors who shared my vision and who were extremely receptive at every stage of the game. We were fortunate to get Dr. Sandeep Kunwar, one of the finest neurosurgeons in the country, to join our facility. On Friday, January 23rd, 2009, a small group of administrators, physicians, along with world-renowned neurosurgeon Charlie Wilson, Professor Emeritus and Cushing Medalist UCSF, and then a consultant at Washington Hospital, flew down to UCLA to the Ronald Reagan Medical Center for a site visit. We had come to visit the operating room of the future. What we witnessed there was pure magic. We were greeted by Dr. Neil Martin, professor and chair of neurosurgery, who took us on this magical tour of his operating room. What we saw was some amazing technology and magic indeed. Global Care Quest, a clinically integrated system which can display lab values, X-rays, CT scans, MRIs, angiograms, PET scans, and even histopathology on large monitors. The Brain Lab, with its digital light box, will allow you to simultaneously import images from 8 different databases. With a touch of a finger, sterile of course, it will allow the surgeon to see scans in different planes and dimensions. It will rotate images as well as measure volumes and distances. We have installed new booms which come down from the ceiling, light sources emitting cool light with minimal shadowing and with a high definition camera. All the tubing and wires, gases and suction, etc., will come down from the ceiling in these booms, so there will be no clutter and no tripping over wires. 5 years ago, we had purchased the very first Lexel Gamma Knife perfection unit in the country. Radiation oncologist Dr. David Larson, who had helped design the perfection unit with Lexel, came and joined our faculty. He recently was awarded the gold medal at ASTRO. Along with Dr. Kunwar, they have teamed up together to perform and help many hundreds of radiosurgery patients on the Gamma Knife. Bloodless surgery without the use of a knife. Last week, we had delivered the Body Tom, a portable CT scanner on wheels. This scanner can be used in the operating room, in the emergency room, and even up on the floors, the very first of its kind on the West Coast. In our totally futuristic operating rooms, we will be able to obtain almost instantly a CT scan to help locate a small brain tumor or to safely perform in spinal surgery pedicle screw instrument placement during the procedure without danger or nerve root injury to the patient. This portable unit can also scan stroke victims instantly as and when they occur. We have purchased a radiolucent operating table in sight, so we can perform the CT scan in our operating room as well. We have successfully accomplished our patient-first ethic, where above all, patient safety comes first.
The age-old question for a surgeon is, can you do this operation anyway with a flashlight and a scalpel? The answer is yes, but this type of surgery is so intricate and so delicate that you're really at a great advantage when you have this kind of technological sophistication.
The fact that our board of directors and our CEO allow physicians to use these tools, that they provide us with these tools, we really are operating now in what we consider to be the operating room of the future.
We all evaluate all these pieces of technology and the equipment at meetings and at different conferences and realize how useful this could be in our operating room suite and to be able to use this for patient care. Now, for the first time, we have the most advanced operating room that exists on the West Coast. What's nice and what's exciting is we finally have the operating room of the future now.
So this development of anatomical technology being shown to us on three-dimensional screens will allow us the precision to pinpoint treatment with accuracy. And so it's the most exciting development that I have seen happen in a long, long time.
Well, thank you. I hope I'm one of those that never have to use it. I'm glad it's there.
Isn't it nice to know it's there in case
yeah.
you do?
Yeah.
I think the thank yous really do belong to the board of directors. You guys are the ones that gave us permission to go forward with that. And we're just so fortunate to have a board that's focused on patient care the way you guys are. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Nancy, and the management staff and the medical staff and all of the associates here, because if it wasn't for the revenues which you earn, we wouldn't have the money to pay for such wondrous achievements in equipment and facilities. So thank you. Okay. We're going to now move on to the consideration of the minutes of the April 11th, 16th, 23rd, and 25th meeting.
So moved with a correction to the minutes of April 11th that the chief of staff elect, or that the chief of staff is indicated as chief of staff and the chief of staff elect.
Okay.
That was pointed out by Dr. Ramon.
Thank you, Dr. Nicholson. I appreciate that.
Second.
All right. All those in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed?
Motion passes. Are there any oral communications this evening? Okay, seeing none, we will move to Dr. Romano for the written communications.
Thank you, Mr. Wallace. I'm pleased to present the credentials action items for the month of April. First, there are four new appointments for whom we are recommending approval of their appointment and privileges as delineated. First is Yusuf Ahmad, anesthesiology, provisional active. Kieran Kapila, medicine, provisional active. Yagya Kapila, gastroenterology, provisional active. And David Voom, pediatrics, provisional ambulatory. There are several reappointments for whom we are granting 2 years, recommending that you grant 2 years. Jeffrey Carmel, dermatology active. John Kniff, medicine active. Sunil Dewan, dermatology active. Harpreet Dillon, medicine active. Joy Rowe Doyle, family medicine, active. Elizabeth Jokers, family medicine, active. Matthew Kanzler, dermatology, courtesy. Prasad Katta, endocrinology, active. Janice Manjak, medicine, / intensivist, active staff. Kishore Nara, physical medicine rehabilitation, active staff. David Orenberg, emergency medicine, active staff. Joseph Schwartz, family medicine, active staff. Jesse Zhang, pathology, active staff, and Gloria Yu, pathology, active staff. We are recommending that you grant a one-year reappointment, a one-year conditional reappointment from June 1st through May 31st of 2013 for Dr. Surinder Sandhu in anesthesiology. And we are recommending transfer to the requested staff category for Joy Rowe Doyle, active to ambulatory, Elizabeth Jokers, active to ambulatory, and Joseph Schwartz, active to ambulatory. We are recommending that you discontinue proctorship and advance to the requested staff category for Anthony Dobson, GYN, courtesy staff, Padmaha Sharma, OBGYN, active staff, and Connie Widowson, also OBGYN, to the active staff. We are recommending that you extend the proctorship and provisional status from June 1st, 2012 through November 30th, 2012 for Amin Alamad, cardiac electrophysiologist, Brian Lipson, allergist, and Paul Wang, also a cardiac electrophysiologist. We are recommending that you extend the proctorship and provisional status from June 1st, 2012 through November 30th, 2012 for Marco Perez, also a cardiac electrophysiologist. We would like to recommend that you approve the additional privilege of deep sedation for Ryan O'Connor from the emergency department. And finally, we have two resignations that we recommend you accept.
Tan An Nguyen from Family Medicine and Shamim Islam in Pediatrics. That's the end of my report.
Thank you, Dr. Romano. May I have a motion for approval of the medical staff credentialing action items?
So moved.
Okay. I have a second.
Second.
All right. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Aye. Motion passes. Good evening, Sharon.
Good evening.
And can we please have your report?
Sure. Short and sweet. The Service League was really busy again in April. at our Service League board meeting, we revised our standing rules for both students and adults to be consistent with twice-a-month service assignments. And the hospital honored us, the volunteers, on May 18th with a Roaring 20s celebration. We all had a great time, right? And we really enjoyed the performance of the dancers. And on behalf of everyone, all the members of the Service League, I want to thank you for making it such a pleasure to be of service to Washington Hospital. And we just concluded our three-day spring $5 jewelry sale. And I'm proud to say that with everyone's help, and there were quite a few volunteers that assisted, probably at least 20 or 30 people, we far exceeded our sales from last spring. It was really a group effort led by Cherie Germondo, and the Service League's commission was just under $15,000.
Wow.
So we were very proud of that. And we also assisted at the following events. The Medicare event, Turning 65, the Aching Knees Get Help event, Go Green Earth Day event, Cyberbully Seminar, and the facts about shingles. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Sharon. Dr. Romano.
Mr. Walsh, I'd like to present the medical staff report. We currently have 21 pre-applications undergoing processing. 11 are sent. 10 have been sent, received, and approved with applications sent. Three of the pre-applications that were sent have been voided because they were not returned within 30 days. There are 16 applications currently being processed. We have the four cases which were presented for board action earlier tonight, and tentatively we have an additional four physicians to be presented next month. There was one set of temporary privileges processed for Dr. Ahmad from anesthesia, who you approved tonight. That brings us all together to 519 physicians and allied health professionals. 394 are in the active and provisional active status. 25 are members of allied health and provisional allied health, and now 43 are ambulatory or provisional ambulatory. That's my report.
Thank you, Dr. Romano. I sometimes get asked, many people are amazed by the number of physicians and the broad range of specialties. And when it's known that we have 519 on our staff and 394 active with all the specialties, it's a major operation that's going on here.
Well, we couldn't do it without Dr. Brooks back there. He helps keep us together.
Yeah, he has no time to practice his golf, that's for sure. No. Okay, we'll have to give him more strokes. That's okay.
Oh, golf tournament is coming.
Yeah. I'm leading into that one for you. Okay, Nancy.
We're going to have our hospital calendar in its new format and have Kimberly kick it off.
As mentioned, this is the second time that we will be presenting the calendar in video format, and then Nancy Farber will then give a few additional remarks at the end. Thank you.
Past health promotions and outreach events include April 2nd, Christy Caracappa presented Turning 65, Get to Know Medicare. April 3rd, Dr. Ash Jane and Doug Van Houten, RN, presented Acute Management of Stroke and Chronic Care and Stroke Rehabilitation. On April 5th, Dr. Ravinder Kalan spoke on diabetes neuropathy, cause, effect, and treatment. On April 16th, Washington Hospital observed the National Healthcare Decisions Day by promoting awareness and information about advanced care directives. On April 17th, the Washington Maternal Child Education Center held its open house. The new center is located at 3569 Beacon Avenue in Fremont. On April 18th, Ohlone College hosted its annual Spring Health Fair. Also on April 18th, Washington Hospital hosted its annual Volunteer Appreciation Luncheon at the Fremont Marriott Hotel. This event occurred during National Volunteer Appreciation Week and honored the excellence of Washington Hospital volunteers. On April 20th, Dr. John Dearborn and Dr. Alexander Saw presented on osteoarthritis and the latest techniques for knee replacement surgery. On April 21st, the Fremont Newark YMCA hosted the YMCA Healthy Kids Day. The event was co-sponsored by Washington Hospital and Washington Township Medical Foundation. Also on April 21st, Washington Hospital's Green Team, the City of Fremont, and other local Tri-City organizations presented the Let's Go Green Together event. This expo raised environmental awareness and shared eco-friendly ideas with people in our district. On April 23rd, the Fremont Police Department presented Digital Safety Cyberbullying. They engaged teens through real stories demonstrating the long-lasting negative consequences of this damaging behavior. On April 24th, Dr. Diane Martin presented Learn the Facts About Shingles. Dr. Martin discussed the increased risk of developing shingles for those who have had chicken pox and are over the age of 50. This event was co-sponsored by Washington Senior Care. On April 25th and 26th, Nancy Farber conducted a CEO Brown Bag informational discussion for employees. The discussion included updates on the progress on the rescue of St. Rose Hospital, Washington Hospital's financial performance, Washington Hospital's new organizational chart, and information on the legislative hearings in Sacramento regarding healthcare districts. On April 28th, the Washington Center for Wound Healing and Hyperbaric Medicine offered free wound screenings. Upcoming health promotions and community outreach events include: on May 10th from 12 noon to 1 p.m. in the Washington Women's Center, Dr. Stacy Berry will present minimally invasive treatments for gynecological issues. On May 10th from 7 to 8:30 p.m., Washington Hospital will host the third annual Celebration of Life event. Cancer survivors and their loved ones are invited to a dessert reception and an inspirational evening with a panel of speakers. The American Cancer Society is co-sponsoring this event. On May 17th from 5 to 8 p.m., Washington Hospital is holding an open house to celebrate the grand opening of the new building for the Center for Joint Replacement. The center is a state-of-the-art facility with joint replacement care integrated into every aspect of the design. The new facility is home to a program that is renowned for excellent patient outcomes and was named the number one joint replacement program in California by HealthGrades in 2011. The program is a national leader, completing over 1,200 joint replacements annually, and has been ranked among the top 10 programs in the state for 6 years and the top 5% nationwide for the past 5 years. On May 21st, from 1 to 3 p.m., Dr. Sanjeev Jain will present on the causes and treatment methods for managing allergies and asthma. On May 22nd, from 1 to 3 p.m., Dr. Annamalai Veerappan will present Crohn's disease and colitis risk for colorectal cancer. This program is co-sponsored by Washington Township Medical Foundation. On May 23rd, from 7 to 8 p.m., Dr. Sabiha Rashid will present New Advances in Lupus. On May 26th from 10 to 3 p.m., the City of Fremont Recreation Services Division will host the Kids and Kites Festival at Central Park Meadow. This event is co-sponsored by the Washington Township Medical Foundation. The Washington Hospital Foundation Report. On April 24th, the foundation held its quarterly trustee meeting with 24 trustees and 19 members in attendance. At the meeting, the foundation presented a check for $750,000 to Washington Hospital to support the building of the new facility for the Center for Joint Replacement. Demetrius Schaefer, president of the foundation, said that he was proud to make such a significant donation to the hospital. A second check was presented by Laura Pisano. Laura Pisano is a charter member of the Service League and current member of the foundation. Laura presented a $75,000 check from the estate of Thomas Faria, her longtime neighbor in Kimber Park. Mr. Faria requested that the donation be designated for hospice care services. On June 25th, the Washington Hospital Healthcare Foundation will host its annual golf tournament at Blackhawk Country Club in Danville. The golf tournament committee is arranging a great day of golf and an entertaining awards banquet afterwards. If you've never had the opportunity to play at this exclusive golf course, this is your chance. For reservations and sponsorship information, please call 510-791-3428. The Washington Township Healthcare District Board Members Report. During the month of April, the district board members represented the hospital at the following community events. On April 13th, Pat Danielson represented the district at the New Haven School Foundation's 5th Annual Pathways to Success Scholarship Luncheon. At the event, Director Danielson presented the Washington Hospital Healthcare System Scholarship to Logan High School student Ashley Hugh. Ashley is a Washington Hospital Service League member who will enter Azusa Pacific University this fall to study nursing. During the month of April, district board members attended the following community events. Washington on Wheels Mobile Health Clinic. During the month of April, the Washington on Wheels Mobile Health Clinic continued to provide healthcare services at the following locations throughout the Tri-City area. Internet marketing. With almost 32,000 visits to the hospital website in April, Washington Hospital's website remains very active. The hospital's employment section remains the most viewed web page. InHealth Channel 78. Washington Hospital's cable channel 78 aired a number of new programs in April, including a public service announcement on shingles and another on advanced directives. The InHealth team continues to work on new programming that promotes health education and general public education and awareness. During the month of April, the Washington Hospital Employees Association, also known as WIA, participated in Undie Monday, which was a sock and underwear drive for those who are less fortunate. A total of 85 items of underwear, 36 packages of diapers, and over 200 pairs of socks were collected. All of the items were delivered to Abode Services for distribution. Abode is a nonprofit organization working to end homelessness. WIA participated in the YMCA Healthy Kids Day 5K Run Walk at Lake Elizabeth on April 21st. 105 employees and family members ran or walked at the event. WIA received a certificate of recognition from the California State Legislature for their dedicated work with Abode Services. Update on preserving St. Rose as a community hospital. April 16, 2012, Alameda County Board of Supervisors Health Committee meeting. Alex Briscoe, director of the Alameda County Healthcare Services Agency, provided an update on the discussion of St. Rose Hospital and Washington Hospital Partnership. The committee reviewed the pending JPA language and the terms of agreement with representation of all parties present. At the conclusion of the meeting, the committee recommended that the JPA go to a full board vote at the next open meeting on April 17th. April 17, 2012, Alameda County Board of Supervisors meeting. The Board of Supervisors voted 5-0 to authorize the execution of the St. Rose Transitional Authority Joint Powers Authority Agreement. Alex Briscoe presented a letter recommending the board's approval of the joint powers agreement between the County of Alameda and Washington Township Healthcare District, establishing the St. Rose Transitional Authority. The JPA includes membership from Alameda County, Washington Township Healthcare District, Eden Township Hospital District, and St. Rose Hospital. April 18, 2012, meeting with Kaiser. Nancy Farber met with representatives from Kaiser to discuss potential funding assistance from Kaiser for the preservation of St. Rose Hospital. April 25, 2012, Washington Township Healthcare District Board of Directors meeting. The Washington Township Healthcare District Board of Directors voted 5-0 to authorize Washington administration to execute the St. Rose Transitional Authority Joint Powers Authority Agreement. Following their vote, the Washington Township Healthcare District Board appointed 5 members to the JPA Governing Board, which will ultimately include 9 members total. From the district, the Governing Board will include Neil Marks, Dr. Albert Brooks, Nancy Farber, Dr. Bernard Stewart, and Gloria Furness.
I have a couple more things to mention. I want to go back for a minute to April 17th and the Volunteers Luncheon. The theme was the Roaring Twenties. And I think that a particular board member deserves a certain amount of recognition for coming fully dressed. And that would be our very own Pat Danielson. Now, the headpiece she wore inspired a certain amount of attention. And Rod Silvera, who's a member of our volunteer community and a foundation board member, was there and decided to offer a $1,000 donation to the foundation if Dr. Stewart would wear Pat's headpiece. And so he did. You might see him down there. And he was a very good sport and wore it for a considerable period of time. Brought $1,000 to the foundation. Thank you. Oh no, that picture is going to be around for a while.
I think it's
every
in
time
the...
we show it, we get 1,000.
Yeah, that's a really good picture. There's several others that go with it. More than one picture was taken. Washington Hospital received the 2012 Partner for Change with Distinction awarded by Practice Green Health. And this was in recognition of our ongoing sustainability and environmental conservation efforts. Practice Green Health is a national membership organization for healthcare facilities committed to environmentally responsible operations. And we want to talk a little bit about the Quest for Zero, which is a program that's organized by Program Beta. And the Washington Hospital Emergency Department nurses and physicians have completed all the requirements for the first year of this program, Tier 1 criteria. The Quest for Zero and Excellence in the Emergency Department Initiative. The initiative is a risk reduction program sponsored by Beta, our liability insurance carrier. The goal of the initiative is to improve patient safety by addressing issues that generate the greatest frequency of emergency department claims. Achieving Tier 1 will result in a 5% reduction in our liability claims, our liability premiums, not claims, premiums. And the awards will take place in October, and our emergency department is already beginning to work on Tier 2 criteria. But we've met Tier 1, and we'll get a 5% reduction in our malpractice liability premiums from Beta for the ED. And finally, the Employee of the Month. For May, Juana Folks is the Employee of the Month. She works in the Human Resources Department as a Human Resources Generalist. She's been employed at Washington Hospital since August of 2000. Initially, she started as the first-line contact for internal and external customers and provided recruitment and employment information to the public, managers, and staff. Because she was so successful in this area, her position evolved and expanded, and she now produces metric reports, coordinates leaves of absences, and updates employee status change reports. She's an employee who takes great pride in her work. And to assist in her overall understanding of human resources, she took the initiative to complete several courses and seminars pertaining to her job scope. She also completed California State University's Human Resource Management Certificate Program at the Hayward Extension Division. She's obviously very well respected by her peers for her knowledge and willingness to lend a helping hand whenever and wherever she's needed. And due to her strong customer service skills, she often receives compliments from both internal and external people visiting our HR department. Outside of work, she enjoys spending time with her family, her husband Dan, and their two sons, Mateo and Jimmy. She also enjoys traveling and has scheduled a trip to Ireland. She also enjoys attending Little League and Junior sports activities with her family. I think the next part of all of this would be the construction update.
Give you something else to build.
Yes, we're down to the details here to finish up. And I should announce before we start, as I'm sure we highlighted, the final review by OSHPD of the CJRs is scheduled to take place on the 15th, and then of course we've got a open house on the 17th. So we're just wrapping things up. This shows you the sort of back 40 of the hospital, and this is the what now has become the new driveway past the central plant. And we're the only things left going on in the central plant is now the laundry, all the equipment in the laundry has been placed, and in the next 2 weeks we'll be moving the dryer and folder and dryer from the existing laundry over to the new laundry, and will be operational in our new digs for the laundry. Got a similar thing going on in terms of paving being finished by the CJR, and also you can see plantings going on, starting to go on. It's not completed yet, but throughout the campus around the CJR, and then you can see that the asphalt has also gone on and striping has occurred around the CJR. The exercise garden outside is in the final throes of completion. There's a few extra plants and things that are going in, but that also is getting completed. And then the last part of this is the entire building is surrounded by a gate, basically for a combination of privacy and security, since that is an inpatient building, to keep any kind of traffic flow away from that building and any of those entries. Any questions? And yes, both projects are just about done, and we will finish them within budget in the CJR and under budget for the CUP.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Ed.
Thank you.
Did you say under budget?
I think he did that.
Yeah.
I said that. We got some money left over for your next project, then.
He's not going to have anything to do.
Yeah. Well, I know. We got to work on that. Okay. Thank you. I guess we're going to now move to the quality report.
Yes.
Okay.
Tonight I'm going to be presenting the nursing dashboard for quarter ending December 2011. And these indicators are the indicators that we have to submit to NDNQI, which is the National Database for Nursing Quality, as part of the magnet designation. So we report it here quarterly, and this gets disseminated to the nursing staff. The areas where we are not in compliance goes back to them. They come up with the action items, they execute it, and keep trying to improve. The first thing we're looking at is the national certification, and research has shown that nurses with higher degrees provide better quality care, and that seems to be panning out. So when you look at us for quarter ending December, which is to the right, we have 38% of our nurses have specialty certification compared to 17% for the NDQI, and NDQI consists of over 1,500 hospitals in their database. And this is for critical care. Looking at it for MedSurg, it's 12% versus 9%. And when you look at it, even though it's 12 or 9, it's statistically significant in terms of the percentage. And again, we continue to encourage our staff to go for the specialty and to go for higher education. And there are many programs within Washington Hospital to help support that progress. Looking at BSN or higher nursing degree, we are 68% compared to 49% for NDNQI. And as you know, most of our new grads are BSN and higher degrees, so that helps in itself. But we also have a lot of nurses that have been here for years that are now going back for their BSN and their master's degree as well. So I think it's an ongoing progress. Looking at it from MedSurg, it's even more significant in terms of 76% of our nurses have BSN or higher degree, and a BSN is a Bachelor of Science in Nursing compared to the NDNQI, which is 39%, and the previous one was for critical care. Looking at catheter-associated UTI infection, we have an anomaly in this quarter, because if you look at the four previous quarter, we had none. And for the quarter ending December, for those 3 months, we had two. The nurses have gone back to look to see what else can be done differently. They're working with the physicians, and they're coming up with a bundle in terms of improving care. We continue to excel, and this is something we take for granted, but we haven't had ventilator-associated pneumonia for going on a year plus or 3 years plus. It's been a while. But again, for this quarter, ending December, we are zero, and we continue to be zero. And that's the work, again, when you talk about teamwork with nursing and respiratory therapists and the physicians, I think it's truly transforming care at the bedside. Look at MedSurg injury falls per 1,000 patient days. We were lower than the NDQI database for the MedSurg. We continue to look at for innovative ways to prevent fall. There is a lot of research out there coming out that we are beginning to dissect and see what are some of the lessons learned that we can implement and customize to meet our patient needs. But it continues to be a challenge out in the community, and we are looking for other ways in terms of how we can prevent falls from an inpatient standpoint. In terms of critical care and looking at pressure ulcer, this is one indicator where the nurses have complete control in terms of preventing pressure ulcer. All the others, there is other involvement and other discipline. But in terms of pressure ulcers, we have done fairly well, and this is for critical care. There is a team of critical care nurses, again, you talk about evidence-based practice and changing care at the bedside, that are working on preventing pressure ulcers in the ICU. They're going back to basics in terms of some of the things that they are looking at. So they are not happy with these numbers, even though they are better than NDQI. They're going for zero. Looking at the MedSurg and pressure ulcer, they continue to do well for quarter ending December. I think when you look at their percentage versus what's NDQI, it's very low to begin with. But again, they are always looking for opportunities in which we can all get down to zero. And that's it. Any questions?
I really like your graphs, so I can follow them really well. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
Any questions, anyone? Thank you. Thank you, Stephanie. Thank you very much. Okay, we are going to move to the finance report with Chris Henry. Hi, Chris.
Good evening.
Okay. Tonight we'll be looking at the financial and operational results for March 2012. Average daily census for March landed at 191.1. We had budgeted for 200.8. We had 1,127 admissions, about 38 below budget, and our patient days were 301 below budget at 5,923. Our average length of stay on a discharge basis landed at 5.39. We'd expected 5.34 in the budget, so the length of stay was pretty close. Case mix index for the month was 1.414, a little bit below budget of 1.462. We had 153 deliveries in the month, about 21 below budget. Surgical cases were 6 below budget. That includes our joint replacement cases that were 10 below budget at 99. Our neurosurgical cases actually came in 1 above budget at 22. And our cardiac surgical cases came in at 10. We had expected 11 for March. PTCAs in March came in at 50. We'd expected 74 in the budget. And outpatient visits were 214 below budget at 9,731. The emergency room continued to be busy. We saw 4,592 patients in the ED. That's 127 above budget. And I think, as Nancy mentioned last month, that's the highest ED number we'd seen since the 90s. Moving into our productivity indicators, we had 1,420.2 productive FTEs for the month. Non-productive FTEs came in at 185.5, so we ended the month with total FTEs 81.5 below budget at 1,605.7. Our FTEs per adjusted occupied bed, which is our productivity measure, came in very close to budget at 6.51, just slightly below the budget of 6.54. Moving into financials, and as always, we'll look at our Governmental Accounting Standards Board presentation first. For those who aren't familiar with that, this is the presentation we use for our audited financials. Total patient revenue for the month came in $2.867 million below budget at $175,985,000. Our contractual write-offs for the month came in pretty close to the budget at 74.33%. So we end March with net operating revenue $917,000 below budget at $45,450,000. Operating expenses for April came in $538,000 below budget at $43,600,000. The variance largely driven by salaries and wages with our lower FTEs in the month. So we end the month with an operating bottom line about $379,000 below budget at $1,850,000. Non-operating income for the month actually came in as a loss of $528,000, and that was driven by some big movement in our unrealized losses on our investments of $1,005,000. So we end the month with total bottom line about almost $2.2 million below budget at $1,322,000. Take a quick look at our Financial Accounting Standards Board presentation. And again, for those not familiar with this is the way the financial markets tend to look at us. Operating bottom line stays the same at $1,850,000. We pull out our property tax revenue that's used to service our general obligation bonds and that unrealized loss on investments to end up with non-operating income from a FASB perspective of $301,000. And a total bottom line of $2.151 million, about $693,000 below budget from a FASB perspective. So are there any questions on March? Okay.
Okay, thank you, Chris. I'm going to go to the operations report.
preliminary results for April this year are we saw 987 patient admissions that resulted in 4,947 days of care. So already you can see there's a precipitous drop in census, and that'll be a theme that flows through this. Our average daily census in April was 165 compared to the prior month. You know, there's more than a whole floor of patients difference. This was lower than March's, which was 191, and the high and low census ranged from 193 down to 138. We haven't seen numbers that low in quite a while. The budget for April anticipated 1,075 admissions and 5,735 days of care, and an average daily census of 191, so we're going to be approximately 788 patient days of care below the budget for the month. in terms of the average length of stay for adults and children, it was lower than budgeted. It came in at 5.09, and we'd anticipated an average length of stay of 5.33. Preliminary information indicates that the inpatient revenue for the month of April amounted to approximately $116,353,000 compared to the budget estimate of $128,535,000. Of this amount, 50.9% was Medicare and 9% was Medi-Cal. And one of the things you may have noticed is there's been a steady trending down in Medi-Cal activity. And we are doing a deeper dive trying to find out why, but probably one of the most obvious explanations is that with the state having the budgetary problems that it has, it could be slowing down Medi-Cal eligibility. And that could be a big piece of this, but we don't know that for a certainty. It's a guess. We had expected, by comparison, 12.6% Medi-Cal. So we had 54.6% of our patient days in Medicare and 9.6% in the Medi-Cal program, for a total of 64.2% in program, government program revenue. In the birthing center, we saw 144 deliveries in April, compared to a budget of 162. Our deliveries resulted in 335 baby days of care. Our newborns totaled 148. In surgery, we had 339 surgical cases at the hospital, as opposed to a budget of 366. This included cardiac surgical cases that were 6 below the budget at 9. Inpatient surgical activity was below budget by 17 cases. Outpatient surgeries were below budget by 10. 515 cases were seen at the outpatient surgery center. Their budget had called for 580. For the month of April, there were 379 cases seen in the cath lab, including 52 PTCAs. Our total cath lab cases were lower than budget by 71 cases. That's nearly a 16% variance. And PTCAs were lower than budget by 17. Almost a 25% variance. Our outpatient procedures were 62, lower than expected. And in terms of non-emergency outpatient visits, for the month of April, we had 8,844. The budget had called for 8,965. The emergency room recorded a total of 4,321 patients with a daily average of 144. 56 visits above the budget. Washington, Warm Springs, Newark, Nakamura, Ohlone, and Walmart clinics saw approximately 4,153 patients during April. Total system emergency room and clinic visits for April came in at 8,474 compared to a budget of 9,355 visits. The place where the precipitous drop in census played out most pervasively was in personnel, because we couldn't flex down fast enough. We flexed down a total of 93 FTEs, but we still come out with a 1.19 FTE per adjusted occupied bed. That's not good. The budget had called for 6.7. In summary, we had 8.2% fewer admissions, 13.7% fewer patient days than anticipated in the budget. Our surgical cases came in below budget by 7.4%. Cath lab procedures were below budget by 15.8% for the month of April. Our outpatient visits for April were 1.3% below budget, so those came closest to budget of all. DR visits exceeded budget by 56 visits, and the clinic visits were below budget by approximately 18%. Total paid FTEs came in below budget by the 93 that I mentioned, 93.3, or 5.7% for the month. And they also were below the last 12 months average by 43.2 FTEs. But the FTEs per adjusted occupied bed still came in at a whopping 7.19. Our inpatient charges for the month are going to be lower than budgeted by approximately 9.5%. Our outpatient charges are lower than budget by approximately 2.5%. So the total hospital charges will be about 7.9% below budget. In April, there were 150 days cash on hand. The total days revenue and accounts receivable at April 30th was 69.35. The days revenue and accounts receivable excluding Medi-Cal was 60.67. And during the month of April, $2,970,344 of charges were approved for charity assistance. Tough month.
Okay, any questions? Thank you, Nancy. We're now going to move to our action items. Director Danielson.
Mr. President, in accordance with district law, policies, and procedures, I move for adoption of resolution 1114, which calls for the district general election to be held in Washington Township Healthcare District on November 6, 2012. For the election of two board members, each for 4-year terms.
Second. Thank you. We have a second. We have any comments, questions? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Item B.
Mr. President, in accordance with district law, policies, and procedures, I move for adoption of resolution number 1115, which calls for the consolidation of the Washington Township Healthcare District election with a statewide general election on November 6, 2012.
Thank you.
Second.
We have a second. Comments, questions? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Item C.
Mr. President, I move for adoption of resolution number 1118, which is the memorandum of understanding between the Chief Executive Officer of the Washington Township Healthcare District, the recognized representative of the Board of Directors and Engineers and Scientists of California, IFPTE Local 20, effective May 9, 2012, under the terms of resolution number 331A, as amended.
Second.
Thank you. Any comments?
This covers about a little more than 90 of our employees. Mm-hmm. They have ratified the agreement, and it calls for an across-the-board 3% in August, and in the subsequent years, 2013 and 2014, 1.5%.
All right, thank you. Okay, all those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passes. Item D.
Mr. President, in accordance with district law, policies, and procedures, I move the Chief Executive Officer be authorized to purchase a split leg surgical table for the operating room for a total not to exceed $68,000. While this particular surgical table was not included in the fiscal year 2012 fixed asset budget, this purchase would be applied to the funds budgeted in the fiscal year 2012 fixed asset budget for an orthopedic fracture table.
Thank you. Second.
Thank you. Any comments?
This is for Dr. Mary Mache. She recently joined our medical foundation as a thoracic surgeon, and she specializes in the surgery of esophagus and foregut. and she requested the hospital purchase a split lid table for use in her laparoscopic surgery. To perform the surgeries of the foregut, she needs to be positioned in close proximity to the lower portion of the abdomen of the patient, and this radiolucent table allows for that positioning.
Thank you. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Item E.
Mr. President, in accordance with district law, policies, and procedures, I move the chief executive officer be authorized to purchase an orthopedic fracture table for the operating room for a total amount not to exceed $70,000. The purchase of this table was included in the fiscal year 2012 capital asset budget. However, the Service League recently donated $70,000 to the hospital for the purchase of a new fracture table, and this generous donation would be used to cover the cost for the purchase of this table.
Excellent.
Second.
Thank you.
Thank you, Service League.
Thank you, Service League.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Thank you. Any items for the closed session tonight? Okay, we are now going to adjourn to a closed session. Thank you all for your attendance.